So today first, before starting our coding, we will learn what is push-based architecture and how it helps in Angular to speed up your project, right? Push-based architecture with RxJS, basically, especially. So first of all, we should understand what exactly this architecture is. Push-based architecture is basically a design pattern that will help you to optimize your performance of your application, right? So there are two types of architectures. One is pull-based architecture, like you can guess, like push is there, then pull should be there. And then another one is the push-based architecture, right? So basically in pull-based architecture, first we should understand so that you can appreciate the push-based architecture and then also learn what exactly how they are differ each other, right? So in pull-based architecture, what happens, right? You are pulling the data eagerly. For example, let's say if there is a component who wants to perform certain action. So it will call some service and say add to cart. And then service will go and talk to the server and save the data into the server. Save the cart item into server and come back to the UI. By that time, UI is waiting because it wants to show the count how many items are there now in the cart. Right? So this is the legacy way of doing it. This is the way that the client is waiting, and then client is again asking service, hey, can you give me the count? So you have to wait till first service is created that item into the cart, and then you have to ask service again to get me the item count, and then you show it in the UI. Correct? So this is the way that we used to do initially, and there are many projects we do like that also, right? So this kind of architecture where the client is performing certain action on service, and in order to get the change that happened, the state, it has to ask the service, okay, and say, give me the change. What, how many counts are there or how many items are there? Those kind of changes, right? So that kind of pool-based architecture it is called as. So means component is eagerly pulling the data from the service. And let's say if you are working in a knockout project or AngularJS project or Angular project or React or Vue.js or whatever. So there what happens, the moment you update the model, Vue automatically gets updated. And the reason behind that is, every time that Angular framework, they make a check. They call the Vue model and check that if this property has value, new value or not. So every time it keeps checking and it checks that if the property has new value, then pull that value. Basically pull that value and put it into your Vue or re-render the Vue. Right? So even Angular also and React.js and everybody works on the pool-based architecture. Means in Angular framework, there is a timer. There is a set timeout that keep running, that interval, set interval time thing, which keep running after certain time and in a loop, right? And it always checks how many expressions are there in the view, and then it checks whether those expression has new value or not. If they have a new value, then you have to re-render the UI. That's how it happens magically. And we see that whenever we are updating model, automatically our views gets updated, how it happens, right? So under the hood, Angular is pulling every time from the view model what is the new value. And then checking if it is new, then re-render the UI. This mechanism is called as pull-based architecture, where your framework is either you are doing it or your framework is keep doing it every time it is running. So somebody is every time working. And that way what happens, your system becomes, your framework becomes slow because framework is busy now to fetch the values, and also your application that you develop also becomes little bit sluggish, right? So one example is this one, like shopping cart example that I drawed here, this diagram. So in this diagram, if you see, this is a shopping cart page, and this shopping cart page basically, and then there is a cart service, and then there is a server. So shopping cart page has a use case called as add to cart. It makes a call to the cart service, and cart service then forward that method to the server. And in server, it says, hey, server, save it. And then it has to wait. Cart service is waiting. This timeline is waiting. And it is saying, ki once this is returned, server save is returned, then basically it is returning to the shopping page saying that add cart is done. Until that time, shopping page is waiting. So this UI thread is hung, basically. It is blocked. And then what happens? you are again asking by your own self. Once the service call is done, then you make another call called as get the card items. And finally, you take the card items and then display it in the UI. So this is a general use case, which is basically called as blocking UI code. So here UI is blocked. Okay. Regardless whether you are doing Angular, React or whichever framework, the design that you did, you choose the way of coding it is blocking your things, blocking your website. So let's say if you have a legacy application, .NET project or jQuery project, where you did this kind of coding, it is blocking your UI. Under the hood, it is blocking basically. Even though you are showing a loading screen, if you don't want to show a loading screen, then it will not work. It will not work means UI will be basically hung, and then you cannot do certain other operations because UI is blocked. So this is the basically I see as a big disadvantage of the pull based architecture. So go ahead. Yes. So you are asking like every time the client has to wait till the server returns the value and then you make a call to get the new changes. And that is true for each and every new change. For example, add to cart, update to cart or whichever cart operations you are doing in the cart service. You are waiting till cart service is done and then you are making another call to do certain different thing to get the changes. What happened basically. So these are the disadvantages, like framework is slow, like I said, hence the application runs slow and system is under performance. And let's say if your customer wanted to place 20 orders, now he ends up placing 5 orders or 10 orders because he's keep waiting. That order has to be created or cart item has to be added and all of that, right? So another thing is UI thread is blocked. Okay. So this is what I was explaining you, regardless of whichever framework we are, either in Angular or Knockout or React, how magically happens that automatically things are updated in the view. This is the background basically, that in the framework, automatically every time there is a check going on, that expression is changed or not. So in Angular, luckily in Angular 2 and 8, there is an option. So they have introduced a concept called as change detection strategy. So this is a new concept. I never taught you guys more detail on it. We can take it later on more detail. But basically, in this exercise, I'll teach you a little bit of what the on push strategy is, and we'll discuss a little bit more on that. So in Angular 2 onwards, they introduced change detection strategy. And in change detection strategy, there are two different kinds of strategy. One is default and another one is on push. Okay. So the default one is basically pull based architecture. So default, if you just create a component in Angular, by default change detection strategy is default way. And basically then you change anytime your model, automatically UI will change, because Angular is by default pulling every time the changes from the model and showing it into the UI if there is a change. So luckily from Angular 2 onwards, what they did is they created another strategy called as on push. Okay, so on push is a new strategy which is there in Angular 2 to 8 onwards, up to 8 is still there, this on push is. So what this strategy means, so in detail we can talk later, but basically in shortcut, if you want to understand what is this change detection strategy on push is, means now if you have a component where you have a cart as an object view model, right? And in the cart, if you updated a value called as the total number of count, how many cart items are there, automatically your views will not be updated. Unless what you have to do is, unless you push it, the value. And I'll explain you, show what basically is the push here. So push means you have to create each value that you want to show in the UI as an observable, first thing. Second thing, you have to do the next on the value on those observable. Whenever you will do next on those observable, your UI will show it. Otherwise, it will not show. So basically, we are saying we have to use RxJS. Use RxJS, convert all of your properties as a basically observables, and then do the next on your observables. Basically, push the value on the observables. So So that way, what will happen is Angular will subscribe all of your changes as a change happened or not happened as a lazy way. Angular will not wait, basically, not keep doing eagerly the pooling thing, right? So in on-push strategy, if you just have a model and you change the model directly, it will not update the UI. So then that is the push. Next is the push-based architecture. So anything in the pool-based architecture, any question? This is clear, right? This. So next is push-based architecture. So in push-based architecture, what happens is basically it's a reactive. This is also called as reactive thing, kind of. And you know, like in the design pattern books, there is a pattern called as observer design pattern. So observer design pattern is what? Basically, you subscribe to an event, and whenever that event and basically subscribe means you are observing an event, and whenever that event occurs, you listen that message, and then you do certain operation on it. So that's observer design pattern, which is basically called as push based architecture also. So that means you are not eagerly asking for something, you are just waiting and somebody is going to push the value to you. Okay, so that's the gist of the post based architecture, and RxJS by default works like that, because all of the observables in RxJS are lazy by nature, means they don't react unless there is something happened. If there is something happened, then only they react, otherwise they are lazy and sleeping. So that way, if you convert your data into observables and your data is now reactive, that way your Angular framework will become more performance. So Angular framework will not update every time view. So Angular framework will see, hey, all of your data are now observable, so I'll subscribe. I'll subscribe or whenever you subscribe and push, then only I'll show. That kind of situation it is. So whenever you subscribe to the data and push the new value into the Angular framework, then Angular framework will display the UI. That kind of it is. So let's talk about the benefits. So how many ways you can achieve this push-based architecture? It's not that only observables are the solutions. So there are two solutions. One is promise, another is observables. So through promise, you can do callback function. So basically, callback function is a key to achieve this push-based architecture. We say that, hey, whenever this event happens, please call this function, and that function is you are providing basically, and whenever that event occurs, somebody will call your function. So that is your callback function. So in promise, you remember we used to do that, where we used to say that whenever this URL is fetched, then call this method. So there is a then function, and then there is a again then function, and so on. So those are the promise callback methods that we had already. However, the only problem with promise is you cannot cancel, you cannot retry. So therefore, the better idea is to switch to observables, and also you cannot play with the multiple data coming from the server or coming from any places. So you have to, every time you have to call it. However, in observable, once you subscribed, then that stream is connected, and every time that data comes, automatically you will get the data. Right, once you subscribe means next time how many times the data will come, you will get that data. So that's the advantages. So I personally like RxJS. Nowadays, initially I used to use messaging, but since Angular is now converted into completely RxJS, so therefore it is good to just switch to RxJS now. So now the thinking paradigm has to change. So instead of saying, hey, I need an item count, so I first call service, do this, and then I wait till this update, and then I ask, hey, what is the item count? So that is the paradigm of thinking, one paradigm of thinking, which is basically pull-based architecture thinking. Now we are saying differently. We are saying, hey, what kind of data I need? So let's say as a component, I need a data called as how many items are added or not. How many items are added? So what I will do as a component, I will create a callback function first, basically saying on cart item added successfully, I need a callback function that I need to create. Then what happens? I'll call add to cart to the service. Service will call to server, but I am not waiting here because I just call it and I am not waiting basically. And then what happens? It goes to the server. Server returns the value to the cart service. Cart service says that I'm saved now. Item is saved. Then cart service will again make a server call to get the data. And whenever it receives the data, it will just call your callback. So your callback function will be called whenever data is updated to the service. Automatically it will be called. So the UI thread is free basically. UI thread is free for accepting another actions. Or even though if you are not doing any another action, but UI thread is free means you can scroll your page, you can do some other stuff. So that is the callback thing. So in RxJS, however, instead of callback, you can do some object-oriented programming properly. And I'll go there slowly. So basically, advantages of the architecture is framework is more faster now, performance is good, and business gets a lot of benefits, and UI is also not blocked. So it's not that it is a cool thing that just do it, right? It basically giving you more business. Okay, and user experience is also very good. So any question on this diagram? So you understand, right? So basically this time shopping page is not waiting and it is just has a callback function, right?